Hello, everybody. Oh, Christ, this is going to get all dramatic. Ah, I should have. Where's the sound volumes? Actually, that's a very good point. Do we get rid of the options? Hello, everyone, and welcome. That was a poor opening, wasn't it, really? To Higher Plane Games. And my name is Simon. And we have Gran Turismo Sport, which came out on the wonderful, wonderful Wednesday. Now, this game is rather fabulous, and I have been enjoying it for the couple of hours that I've played it, and you can kind of see how long and not long I've played stuff. Now, that's rather frustrating. I don't want to turn off the music that's actually in. I do want to turn it off in the race, because then I will be absolutely ruined, I'm sure, in the comments themselves and by YouTube for its demonetization. Ah. Right, sorry for that terrible introduction. Let me just crack open a cider. Cheers, everyone. So, this game has been out for a couple of days. When I bought it, my own silliness, really. There's a few things that I didn't know about the game before I'd actually bought it. The first one really being that this game, it's not online only, but it's online prominent first. So AI stuff and single player modes aren't necessarily its main thing. So when you go to the arcade, you've got single races and so on and so forth, but there's no actual like championships that you can build or anything like that. Or even like you can do a custom race, but you can't do a custom set of races to create an offline championship for you to play with, which seems a bit weird and short-sighted. In the campaign itself, you've got driving schools, which is like your tutorial kind of mode, mission challenges to do certain types of things with different cars, and then circuits to go around the circuits and learn them off by heart. Then you've got online stuff for races, Grand Central, where you go and buy the cars, Lobby, which is where you can join online stuff. But the sports stuff works very much like iRacing, if you've ever played iRacing before. So there's always stuff. I should do the don't display. So you've always got races like every 10 minutes or so that you can then dive into and run. This is where you do have specific rounds for championships, but it's like mass online stuff, which is less excited. Now that's 20 minutes away. Oh, that's just 2 minutes away. Let's do this one and let's enter the race. Cars are grouped into different group sessions so that you can kind of pick and choose what you want to go for. Let's go for a Megan. And you can see that it will then automatically change regulations to stuff so that you can, if the car's too heavy, it will lighten it, or vice versa. And the Merlin Megane is underpowered, so it needs to be boosted 5% for it to basically be classed as a regular thing that it can do. Let's dive into qualifying. And what will be going on across the world is that anyone else that has then come into this race and has signed up for this race will be trying to get qualifying times within the next couple of minutes, and it's normally about a 15 minute period that you can sit there and qualify and tune your car to, which obviously we're going to miss out on dramatically. But never mind. So let's try and get out there. Those are people who are on my friends list. Anyone's played F1 2017? Spot. Oh, Christ. So this is me taking on cars that I've not really driven properly. So I'm running on manual gears, which you can see kind of pop at the bottom. You'll see the recommended stuff for each corner as you go through. awesome in cockpit mode for this game specifically. There is no weather in this game, if you didn't know. There is a like dawn to dusk cycle. It's probably the best way to describe it. Get a ghost car that will go round. So we've only got 10 seconds, we won't be able to do another lap beforehand. But essentially, during this 15 minute period, you'll have the chance to. Hey Roy! I didn't know you had a PS4, Roy. Thank you for joining. So I'm glad that we are now chums. So whilst we're just finishing off our lap here, which is so much better now that we've actually learned how to drive this car for a lap. We will then be matchmaked with various people vaguely around our skill level about all the people that have then created and done a lap during that period and signed up.
I wrapped it earlier today, grinning face.
Ah, good stuff, Roy. That is my livery on my Megane. That is my helmet livery so far, because I've not bought and unlocked lots of other helmet designs or overall livery as well. So I'll go into currency and stuff like that in a little bit of time to try and explain how that all works. But yeah, I think what really struck me with the whole sport aspect is how much it's mixed on. So how much of an influence it's got on iRacing. And there we go. My lap wouldn't count, it looked like. So God knows what this is going to look like. 24 guys going nuts all at once. But this will show quite garingly how my races work. Now try and be quiet. So, just to take a look at what you can do in a car setup. So, all of this is pretty much locked in. Because we're in sport mode, and sport mode locks your setup. So, if you don't like the setup that they put you on, you're buggered. Does look gorgeous, even if there are no round effects. No damage. Okay, wish me luck. Glah, everyone, glah. This always confuses me as well. The whole way how you're not in car when you code to the lights. I feel a little bit like I'm in an out-of-body experience at the beginning. When contact happens, people grey out quite quickly, and I really appreciate that, because some of the driving, as you can see with me there, is not great at all. And that does affect your safety rating quite dramatically, actually. The one thing I will say about this GT Sports stuff, with this online mode we have, is you spend so long potentially doing qualifying laps, but then the races are always really, really short. Don't diss my McGann, Roy. Oh, Christ. So, yeah, I kind of... It makes it then very, very difficult, because when you're driving online, and I find this with the PS4 just in general, is that because... Yeah, you can see my SR rating went down because of that hit. If you're then going to make your own types of racing, you can exclude people with like terrible safety ratings, which is fine. But it makes it very difficult that this whole game is really built on the premise of racing online rather than offline. If I was trapped up against randomers all day long, I think I'd cry and I'd want to return the game. I appreciate I'm not showing my best foot forward here.
I don't think we did. No! Dang it.
Oh, I reckon they gave us a penalty as well in all of that. Yeah, 3 seconds.
Boo!
But it doesn't tell you where the penalties happen. Or if they do, I don't spot it very often. So there's like really specific things that kind of make me go, ooh, why doesn't that happen? And I don't know if that's because I come from a PC racing background where I like league racing stuff, where I assume these types of things are available. But yeah, it kind of, there's really unique things that I kind of think, why is that missing? Or why is that like that? So yeah, bit random. So, experienced driver, trophy. So, well done, Nutjob 775. So, you get prize money for spending on cars, mileage points for buying other things, distance you go towards a daily workout, which is driving the equivalent of 26.2 miles, which is a marathon. Now, you can see my driving rating is an E. Because I'm still new. Safety rating is a B. But you can see other people there like a C because they've dropped out or they've smashed into too many people. And then you exit out of the room afterwards, and that seems like an unnecessary extra that they've put in. I'm not sure why that works on its own. So but there we go. So should we try? Let's go for the Brands Indy circuit again. And this is a Honda Civic. Oh, should we go? Let's go Pearl. So the BOP regulations reduce things down slightly. So if you time it right, you can get in and like do a really quick quali lap and be like, da-da. But occasionally it doesn't really work out like this whatsoever. And then once we've done this, unless there's something juicy that comes up, we'll start plucking about the offline stuff. The other thing that I find slightly confusing is that all the saves for this game are saved online on the server. And there's not really a specific reason as to why. So when I'm... you have to manually save offline to kind of make sure that it works. because what I found already during this game several times is that if the server gets bogged down, it will then just go, I can't save your game, and keeps popping up with a message every time you like change a menu. And currently the response is wait 15 minutes, because that's when the server decides if it's overloaded or not and will then let you have another go. But it annoys me that it's not saved offline. And again, it kind of makes me think, right, well, at some point when the servers turn off for this game, the game will be in part useless, because like, how will the content work offline? I mean, I know you can do offline races, but you're still having to connect, it feels like. There. So other things that we've got that's going on. You can see I've got the track map in the top left and bottom right. Sorry, top right and bottom right of the corner. Let me get out of this tricky final corner. So you can also switch that over to radar, which can be really, really helpful in pack racing to kind of see what's going on, because some people have kind of gone, oh, where's the arrows to kind of help people understand where other cars are, which we're used to not having Christ's in more league style stuff, but those people that need that kind of thing, radar is very, very handy. Or you can just have like your times up as well. We're going wide. Saved. Just good job there's no like braking engine mode around here. What you can also do on that display, oh Christ, we're really spinning it off around here, is change the traction control up and down. I'm doing this with the D-pad, by the way. And also brake balance. So if you find that you're overshooting or undershooting, that's quite handy to play with. So quite often I find, because those are the only two things, let's go for a crash, they're the only two things you can really like play with on the sport wire, on the sport settings anyway. It's quite handy to have. Right, let's see what idiots we are matched up with for me to be idiotic with. I do like how I've been able to get yellow and purple into everything.
Edgy.
Oh yes, please let us be sick from the grid. Though I have a feeling they'll be just at random. So when you're looking at driving options, you can choose between manual and automatic transmission.
The touch with the indicator lights, smiling face with open mouth.
So I've turned auto drive off. There is no assists or anything like that on at all, particularly for like visual stuff. So that's all good. I like the pit cruise. That makes me happy. I always do that on this track. It always takes me like a couple of laps to sort myself out. Can't tell if that's on a hot lap or not. Used these days to open wheeled cars where I can see everything around and I'm sat in the center. This always takes me a little while to kind of flick back across again. So when we do a fail cast with me and Ben tomorrow in F1 2017, I'll have to do like a quick 20 minutes beforehand to remember how to drive that car. There we go. Oh okay, it looks like we're 16th on the grid. Glad. see that SR, my safety rating went up there because I did a nice clean sector according to the game. Which might not last for much longer! Damn it, cat's kill. Oh, he's coming through. Oh shit. Oh, okay. And there you go, so you just get like punted off everywhere. And I guess. Because it's just randomers, such a problem, such a pain. This just brings me back to McGann Trophy, USAR, on our Factor 1. Which, if you could survive the first few corners and be okay with, then you'd be alright. Because then the competent ones would be there. But yeah, everything else is a bit like, ah. See, but smacked again. And because these races are just four laps, like round this one, and it was five round Suzuka short, you kind of think, well, how am I ever supposed to get out of this crash fest? That's a couple of laps on GT Sport mode. I would hope that over time people would just want to smash around everywhere would kind of go away a little bit. The other really interesting thing about this game is that...
Sorry, I'm peeking on the microphone.
Before you are allowed to even go online, you have to watch a 5-minute video about how to have good racing etiquette, which I thought was actually quite cute. So get some popcorn for that, because it basically says stop being a crashing jerk, but also it's down to the person being napalmed to get out of the way. Which I think is valid, but also a bit like sometimes you just can't avoid people being shit. So that's that for now. You then have FIA official stuff that you can then play around with and do. We can't really deal with any of that currently at the moment, so let's dive out of sport mode. Every time you level up, you unlock new rewards, which you can then take into arcade mode. What's going on there? There There we go, thank you. So arcade mode. Lets you take off all those different tracks, and the tracks unlock as you level up as you go along. So when you first get the game, I think you've got just the first three or five, and then like level two you get Magione and so on and so forth. So more and more unlock as you go, and you can see level 10 all the way through to level 20 where Nürburgring becomes available. And then as you can see, you've got blue, yellow, red, and that's the three difficulty levels of the AI that you can face around here. So let's take... Let's do the streets of Willow Springs. So you then get the chance to choose sunrise, sunset, dusk. Let's go for dusk because we've not done anything in the night yet. These are the cars that I have bought currently at the moment, so not a massive selection, it must be said, but you can see with the stats for them there. Let's go for that. That looks like I won't be able to control it. So you then have a colour selection, but the menu for that is really confused. There's only one colour for it, so you've only got that there. As you buy more colours for certain types of cars, and that's all fine. And then you have beginner, intermediate or professional. So I'll go for intermediate because, you know me, middle of the road at all times in life and in general. And then what it will do, same as you saw beforehand in the GT Sport category, it will kind of level off some of the cars slightly in their overall top speed and performance figures. Each car will still have its own individual characteristics, but they'll kind of be cramped a little bit into the groups that they're in. Which is fine. I don't mind that at all. But then in this mode, you can see you have... excuse me, the ability to play around with the setups and so on and so forth. Now this is a road car, it's not a drift car, so you can't deal with any of the drifting that's going on around here. But as you can see, the car setup, you can really, really play with if you want to. The other thing that you can do... There you go, balance of performance is off for this at the moment. But you can change stuff for the circuit itself. So you can see, like, the power ratio has gone down because this car's probably a little bit more over the top compared to other ones, which I quite like. Because I will probably suck because this is going to be a faster car that I'm used to. And I've not driven the circuit yet. So be kind. Wow, the circuit's a bit... chosen the car that's probably the least likely to drive around this circuit. Bye bye Cone, we loved you much. As you can see, the AI are okay and they're relatively competent. But they don't seem to like hairpins very much, I noticed. And it's specifically hairpins or really tight chicanes, like the stuff that we had down the back. So I didn't realise that this circuit, I thought this circuit was a little bit longer than what this is. So apologies that this is turning into a Smithy overtaking with a way better car and looking better than he probably is, in the case. But I do like with the AI that they don't just drive completely on rails like previous Gran Turismos. Before, they would just nerf you off because they were on a predetermined set path. Now, they actually react like you're there part of the time, which is great. I feel like I'm doing that corner wrong, but I don't care. Oh, that's helpful. Hello? Does bumper cars. What kind of circuit's that? We have a weird one. Oh. Nearly got the car. There we go. At least that shows off the dusk effect. Let's spin a positive on this. And there you go, so you get your prize money, your mileage, your distance, and your experience as you go. And that all happens across whatever mode that you're doing, so you aren't penalised by staying offline. Much like how, if I know it's a completely, it's a crap comparison, but with Micro Machines World Series, when that first came out, you could only get XP when you raced online, and no one wanted to race online because the server was laggy as hell, so then no one was earning any XP and no one was playing, so then the game just like died on the spot. Now they've done it so that you actually have it offline, so that's all good. Should we have a look at Drift? Because I personally haven't actually touched Drift yet. Do like a good bit of sunset. Let's do the Lexus. So there we go. So there we go. We've got a selection of paint, and you can see how it all changes as you go through, which is quite cool. Let's stick with orange. And after this, we'll go into the car garage and we'll buy something. So I can show you that as well. Oh, hello, man. Thank you. drifting work.
Like that.
I'm shit at drifting. Don't boo me, bitches! Come on! I can't even work out where we're supposed to be going. Mainly because I can't see out the car. It's actually really hard. Hey, thank you. I feel like I've done this horribly wrong. Really? This is why I hated drift mode in Colin McRae Rally. Novice drifter. Well, that was fucking awful. I'm so sorry that you had to watch that. Moving on. But again, that will also come down to car choice versus like what's actually good, what's not good, that kind of stuff. So. Two-player split screen. I've not got a I've not got any friends to test that out with. Sob sob. Custom race. Where haven't we been yet? Not been to Blue Moon Speedway. That well known. Oh, it's a. Ooh. It's Pocono. let's not go there. That's just going the other way. Nope, we don't want to do that. That looks confused. Let's do that. And again, let's go for sunset for sexual appeal. Let's grab an Alfa Romeo. Keep it in red. So, what you've got, you can do laps or you can do endurance, which is where you set minutes. And you can see how it changes the difficulty as you go along. And then your laps. You can really go up. So if you want to go for like a proper endurance-y type stuff, then that's great. Only 20 cars on this one. Your rolling start interval between people you can deal with. So boost is essentially rubber banding. It's not rubber banding. It's slipstreaming. No. Ah! It is rubber band. Sorry, I'd gone cross-eyed for a minute. Mechanical damage. Do you want to have that on or off? So if you do smash into a wall, then that would be great. Let's go for heavy. Tire wear, we'll go for 1%. Fuel depletion, we'll pop that on. We'll go for a real grip. And you can change, like, what do you want for penalty-wise and stuff like that. And it's really here is where everything kind of comes of age, if that makes sense. Because so much of what you do that's standard out of the box doesn't let you tinker with so much of what is in that menu. And so if you just literally play around with arcade mode and then the online stuff, you're missing out on so much of what Gran Turismo Sport has to offer. And that's one of the really weird design things of this whole game, is that actually all of the nuance and detail is really hidden away. You don't come across half of that if you don't go into the menus and play with it. And that to me feels like a bit of a weird and lost opportunity. In the same way that F1 2017 at the moment has this menu where it lets you play out with race 1 and 2, but race 2 is always chopped off, and you can't like create a bespoke championship where you could have reverse grid races and that kind of stuff. It just feels to me like you've put the tools in front of me, but then not allowed me to play. And that always strikes me as a weird design decision, personally. So, quite possibly, they should run a track like this in NASCAR. I feel like I want to go three wide. It's dirt. Yeehaw! No! So, mechanical damage. I hit the left side. My car... This is me with a straight... line, could you see how it's already like kinking out to the right hand side, which will make these corners a breeze. Chose the right corner to hit the wall. Oh dear. And you can see there I've got a flashing front bumper. And my right front tyre. So you can see that the suspension is deranged. You can also see my fuel load consumption going on as well. For endurance races. I'm talking about the panel across the bottom. Sorry, I didn't make that clear at all. Oh! Oversteer! Doink. So now both my tyres are screwed. Obviously, same as before with Gran Turismo, no actual physical damage to cars. It is all implied mechanically. Yeah, now look, my car wants to turn more left than right. You're driving terribly now. Just because I want to show you how the damage level... How the damage kind of works. But at the moment, it's still drivable, even though I've smashed into several walls at high speed. So the damage model is extremely forgiving. So... It again harks back to the whole criticism I think that Gran Turismo has had before, which is where it's a driving simulator, not a racing simulator, if that makes sense. And I think actually even like the marketing kind of distinguishes between the two, I think. It's just such a shame that I guess that licensing and the inability for brands and companies to distinguish between real life and virtual reality computer games. That kind of stuff happens, I guess. I don't know. It's weird. It's also like I'm waiting. This is me going off on a bit of a moment tangent, so I do apologise. Okay, have I done all four tyres yet? No, I haven't. But now look. So even more damage. Everything's going all over the place. Now the car is wildly veering. But what it hasn't done, and I'm sure it will do, although I've yet to actually make it do it, is you can really screw up the gearbox and the engine, hopefully. But I wonder if that will let you, because again, of this whole licensing problem you've got. But I'm waiting for, basically, if there's a huge car crash in real motor racing, and it's, there's an esports category attached to it, that the esports category will no longer allow a game to roll a car or lose a wheel or something like that. I'm waiting for that kind of stupidity to transcend into esports. It's a stupidness waiting to happen. Anyway, enough of my psycho babble. We reached our marathon. The first time you do that, you get a trophy. I've not seen anything exciting happen afterwards. Oh, gift card, that's why. What are we going to get? I love this sequence, by the way. There's a quote from the guy that makes this game and this series. And he says, I want every car that you get. Oh, there we go. That's my 10th car. Trophy. He said he wanted every car that you get to be fit, to be like being given a bespoke present. And I love that. So just the theatrics of it all is great. So in the Brand Central, that's where you can buy stuff. It's divided to America, Europe and Asia Pacific. Clearly no African cars are in this game. Let's go America. Fittipaldi. What are we going here? Ooh. So in addition to some of this, you also get like a channel where you've got different like promotion stuff for different events. So Tag Heuer have their own little thing in here, and it's just all about showcasing adverts for watches that are inspired by racing drivers. It's a really odd, I get why, but it strikes me as odd all at the same time. So you can go to their channel where say like Ford have got different things, so Andy Priya going around in Goodwood, that kind of stuff, and I love all of that kind of stuff. I do wish with the PS4 though, the PS4 transfers every single bit of the game onto your hard drive, and this I think is about 70 gig. And if anyone's watching, on day one they also released a 9 gigabyte free update for landscapes, so that when you buy cars you can place them on landscape pictures and like play around with photo mode and shit like that, which is great, but it kind of makes me go, argh! I don't want to spend 9 gigabytes downloading amazing... Oh, I've already got that car. That imply I've already got it? Surely not. Surely the blue tick's just stuff that I can buy. Right, let's grab a Mustang. So when you go into this, you've got dynamic screens or studio scenes. Can't be bothered with that. I like dynamic because I like to be able to change the options. So what would I want? And this is the whole 9 gigabyte stuff. So you've got this is what comes with the game, but there's 9 gigs worth that you can now download and have in addition for all of these beautiful little screens. What do I fancy? Let's go ruby red. Let's purchase that. Noish. So it's been added to your garage. You can change the car if you want to. Continue on. You can see that my stuff's gone down there. You can see Europe with the Tag Heuer brand. So it's so strange. Oh, that looks really ugly. It looks like a bug splattered on it. Oh, Etna Black. Is that like Mount Etna? Oh, go on now. You tease me, sir. You tease me. And I like to not buy the expensive cars to see if I get them as a gift. So that's why I buy all the cheap tit. So yeah, so that's how that kind of works. We'll go on to scapes in a second. But then down the side here, you've got your home stuff, the livery editor, which you get along. But as you saw, we got cash, but you also got mile exchange points. And what the mileage exchange basically lets you get stuff that kind of goes around on rotation. So the idea with this is you can buy custom wheels for your cars. The BMW safety car, I do want that, to be fair. I don't have the mileage coins for it. Decals to use in a livery editor. Different helmets. Profile poses for yourself. Special paint colours. Ah, that blue tick then means that I've already bought... Ah, I've bought the same car twice, you twit. Because I did buy that BPY one. Let's get it for cash. So that's all good. Oh, that gives me an achievement. And so also what's going on along the side, because what this game really does is incentivize you to continue just doing random stuff, is going to your mileage, your achievements. And as you can see, you've got loads and loads of different like levels of stuff that you go to. So how many times have you been on pole position? How many liveries have you created? How many photos have I liked by other people? But this one's for mileage points used, so you get another 200 for that. 500 experience. Ah, doesn't quite get me to level 10. You also get your life log, so that you can kind of see what I have and haven't done. My daily workouts of how much of campaign and stuff like that I've done. So, people that know me well know that I do love a stat. So you can go by week, by month, that kind of stuff. And a gallery I've not done anything with yet. Apart from my initial helmet. Or suit, which doesn't seem to have popped up anyway. Right. Just trying to think of what else people might want to see. Oh God, yes. Well, that's just made that exciting. So you can follow people, you can look at their profiles and all of that kind of stuff. You can enter comments as to what you like and what you don't like. I love how they've managed to do that. And so there's kind of like a whole extra mode of things looking good, things not looking... things looking good, or like posing things out there. I like that. And then you can filter by what's trending, what's not trending, that kind of stuff. Oh, and the game's just crashed. So that's that. Wow.